Hello, everybody. My wife and I are delighted to be here in Poland, especially for a meeting on the delightful subject of beauty. Now, I don't know what it is, but I'm very enthusiastic about beauty. But before I start giving you a few ideas about beauty, I'd like to pay homage to the wonderful Polish mathematicians, especially in set theory and logic. So for that reason, it's a particular pleasure to be here in Poland, since I've always admired the kind of mathematics done here. I've always had the feeling, maybe I'm wrong, that nobody cares about practical applications, and here mathematics is pursued solely for beauty. At any rate, I feel that mathematics should be done that way, so I feel very much at home here in Poland, where I believe that's part of the mathematical tradition. Also, my wife and I would like to thank the organizers for inviting us. We come from very far away, from Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. And we're pleased as punch to be here. So the topic of my talk is, the title of the talk is Beauty in Physics, Math, and Biology. And this is actually a talk where I'd like to tell you, I'm not a philosopher, I'm a mathematician, but I'd like to tell you, I'd like to try to be a philosopher a little bit, and I'd like to tell you about some ideas that start with Leibniz. Leibniz is a wonderful thinker. He died in 1716, so this is precisely 300 years from his death. Why don't we write his name down here, since the lights have gone off. Does that work? Is it visible, or shall I just talk and not write anything? Yeah, well, anyway, this is just... Okay, so Leibniz is a wonderful thinker. He was already mentioned in the lecture yesterday by Julian Barbour. Julian referred to the monadology. And he quoted a text, which to me seems to be a sort of a faint echo of what I think is a much more interesting text in an earlier writing by Leibniz, which is called it was written in French, it's called the Discours de Métaphysique, Discourse on Metaphysics. And that's a work from 1686. 1686 is a long time ago. It's a very long time ago intellectually. It was the year before Newton's Principia. So you understand this was a different world. In particular, I'd like to tell you about sections or paragraphs 5 and 6 of the Discours de Métaphysique, which I think are extremely interesting. And I didn't discover this material by Leibniz. My field is complexity, simplicity and complexity. And these are ideas of Leibniz on complexity, simplicity and complexity. And they were discovered, their significance was appreciated for the first time by a wonderful mathematician and theoretical physicist called Hermann Weyl. In two books, one of them is, so let's write down Hermann Weyl. In two books, one from 1932 and one from 1949, the 1940 book is Philosophy of Math and Natural Science, I think, Princeton University Press. The 1932 book is called The Open World, if I'm not mistaken. The Open World. Those are two books on philosophy of Hermann Weyl, who also wrote books on pure mathematics and wrote books on theoretical physics. And it was reading Hermann Weyl that I learned about Leibniz. So let me tell you about this text by Leibniz. Paragraph 5 by Leibniz says the following. Julian referred to this idea sort of yesterday, at least in the version in monodology. The idea is as follows. God, this sounds like theology, God has created the most perfect world. On the one hand, the world is very rich and diverse in phenomena. For example, it includes us. But on the other hand, God is parsimonious in the ideas that are used to create this world, in the mathematics, in the laws of physics that are used to create this world. So God is simultaneously maximizing the richness of the world and minimizing the number of bricks, of concepts, of laws that create this world, that make this world function. And it's in this sense that Leibniz says this is God has created the most perfect possible world. Now, I think you've all heard Voltaire mocking Leibniz. Voltaire was an atheist. Leibniz was a theist. You know, the joke about Voltaire, it's the best of all possible worlds and everything in it is a necessary evil, right? But Voltaire didn't understand Leibniz's concept in what sense this is the best of all possible worlds. It's the best of all possible worlds in a very abstract sense. What Leibniz is really saying is the universe is comprehensible. The universe is comprehensible. He doesn't say it in these terms because God is a great artist who has created a wonderful work of art starting with very few elements. These elements would be the laws of physics, the mathematical laws that create the world. So to say that the world seems very rich and diverse but actually is the product of very simple laws, a simple set of ideas, is to say basically that science is possible, that the world is comprehensible. So the perfection of a God consists in the fact that we can comprehend the world. Now, by the way, Leibniz was a rationalist optimist. He believed in reason. He has a principle called the principle of sufficient reason, which says that if anything is true, it's true for a reason. Now, if you apply this to contingent, which are sort of chance or historical facts, like who is the president of France at a given moment, Leibniz does think that this also happens for a reason. Actually, it happens for an infinite chain of reasons, says Leibniz, which only God can comprehend, but escape the power of the human mind to comprehend. But he still believes everything happens for a reason. So this is the optimistic view that reason can understand everything. So first of all, there's this text, which is paragraph 5, which in a way is already talking about simplicity and complexity, because it's saying the world is very complex, but the ideas or the laws that construct it are very simple. And this is why science is possible. This is why the world is comprehensible. This reflects the perfection of God to create such a world. Okay? So this is simultaneously sounds like something theological, but on the other hand, it's explaining why science is possible. And at that time, science was just beginning. You realize that it was only a year later that Newton's Principia was published. So I think it's very interesting that Leibniz immediately puts his finger on why is science possible? Or what does it mean to say that science is possible, that the world is comprehensible? Now, the sixth paragraph, paragraph 6, is even more interesting than paragraph 5 because it talks more specifically about laws of physics and their complexity and simplicity. So let me tell you that text. All of this I learned reading Hermann Weyl in the two books that I mentioned here. So let's see, did I put here also, let's put the original source, which is, this doesn't look too readable. Maybe it is, maybe it isn't. By the way, Leibniz didn't give this name to this document. These were notes that were found a century after his death by an editor, and this is the name given to these notes by the editor. Leibniz's works and ideas are scattered. There's no definitive statement. He didn't publish a definitive work. Many of his best ideas are written in letters to other intellectuals of the time, and they're continually being developed. Leibniz is constantly changing his ideas, and also he's constantly going from field to field, throwing out brilliant ideas. Okay, so let's go to paragraph 6. So it was paragraphs 5 and 6 in the original there with Roman letters, 5 and 6. You can get the original, well, not the scan of the original document. You can probably get that from Hanover. But if you go to the website of the Bibliothèque Nationale de France, they have available for free a scan of a edition of the Discours de Métaphysique, which is more than a century old, which compares it against the manuscript. It's the version that I looked at. In the original French, it's very straightforward, simple French. I could understand it even. Very much like modern French, except the spelling is different. But Leibniz thinks clearly, so he writes clearly, so it's easy to understand. Okay, so what is paragraph 6? Paragraph 6 discusses what is this idea of a law of physics or a scientific law. So the idea is this. Let's say you're looking at a physical system and you're measuring some important property of the system as a function of time. What does it mean to say that this physical system follows a law, or that you can understand the behavior of this physical system? When is there a law and when is it lawless? So Leibniz says, well, let's imagine, in fact, that physicists always use graph paper, right? So they have graph paper and they have a graph of the behavior of the physical system. So a graph would go something like this. You know, here you have time, here you have some important property of the behavior of the system, you will have points that you will measure your experimental data, and what does it mean to say that this physical system is comprehensible, that there is a law explaining the behavior of the physical system? And in particular, Leibniz says, what happens if these points are chosen at random by taking a quill pen and sort of closing your eyes and making spots of ink on the paper? So Leibniz says, well, you might think that what it means to say there's a law is if there is there is some equation, some mathematical equation that passes through those points. However, says Leibniz, it doesn't matter how crazy the points are, even if they were generated completely at random, because there's always an equation which will pass through a finite set of points. And this is, in fact, the case. So, says Leibniz, any finite set of points, there's going to be an equation passing through exactly through those points and even in a particular order. So, says Leibniz, what's enabled you to tell points which measurements which come from a physical system which obeys a law and distinguish that from points which are measuring a physical system which is lawless, which is random, which is incomprehensible, where science, a world in which science doesn't apply? Well, says Leibniz, if the equation is simple, he uses the word simple in French, simple, then it's a law. But if the equation is very complicated, then there's always an equation, and that's sort of meaningless. It doesn't enable you to distinguish a system which obeys a law from a system which is just completely haphazard. Okay? And the actual French that Leibniz uses in the original document, when you see modern translations especially into other languages, they'll say simple or very complicated. The original, there was, the word complexity didn't exist in French at the time. Simplicité did. But in 1686, what Leibniz says is fort composé, which means highly composed, which is pretty close to the idea of complexity. Okay? So this is a deep idea, Hermann Weyl points out, because, you see, let me give you... Hermann Weyl has a number of ways of pointing out how deep this idea is. One way is to say that... Let me say, use exactly Hermann Weyl's words. If you allow arbitrarily complicated laws, the concept of a law becomes vacuous because there is always a law. How's that? I think that's pretty good. I was shocked when I heard it. I thought it was... Nobody seems to react, so maybe I have to say it differently. You see, we're trying to distinguish... Presumably, if you toss a coin or do something like or a roulette wheel or you use dice, you get something that's completely random, so there is no law. But if you're measuring, say, the positions of the planets in the solar system, there is a law. The laws are called Newton's laws of physics. So we want to distinguish a universe which is comprehensible from and lawful from a universe which is random and lawless. That's the idea. This is a metaphysical question. So if you allow arbitrarily complicated law, there's always a law, and the concept of law becomes vacuous. Another, we're talking about a finite set of data, finite set of points, experimental data. Another way to put this, Hermann Weyl puts it, is the concept of a law of physics really is a couple. It's not one concept, it's two concepts. It comes with the concept of complexity. Because in the concept of a law of physics, without a companion concept of complexity is meaningless. You really need the two together. So anyway, this is Hermann Weyl's appreciation or expansion, if you will, of Leibniz's original idea. Now we have a problem with all of this. Problem. How to measure complexity. So the idea that Leibniz and Weyl are talking about is that, roughly speaking, the complexity is the size of the equation. That's sort of the idea. The size of the equation, that's the law, the equation that goes through the data points. Now, this is not a very good definition of such a fundamental concept, such a philosophically, epistemologically, metaphysically fundamental concept as complexity. Why? Because mathematical notation is very arbitrary, and it changes as a function of time. And, you know, do you include trigonometric functions? Do I include Bessel functions? You know, the notation in Euler's time was different from notation in our time. So that's not a very satisfactory definition of something so basic for the philosophy of science. So how can we define this concept? How can we give a rigorous, more precise definition of this fundamental concept? And there is a solution to this problem, which has just happened starting in the 1960s. So let me tell you about this way to make Leibniz's and Weyl's idea more precise. Hermann Weyl and Gottfried Leibniz's idea more precise. So we have to change the context. We're not going to talk about points on graph paper and an equation passing through those points. We're going to have a different notion of what our experimental data is that we're trying to understand or explain, and we're going to have a different notion of what a theory is. So how are we going to do it? This is an idea that comes from the 1960s. There were versions, there were three of us which sort of came up with those ideas, but there were only two of us who were concerned with modeling the scientific method. That was Ray Solomonoff and myself. Kolmogorov had some related ideas, but he did not look at the scientific method. He was not trying to understand this. So the idea goes like this. I'm giving you my version of this. You have a computer. Okay, so you have a computer. And the idea is that you have a theory going in, and what it's going to do, it's going to calculate your experimental data. This is what it means to say that a theory explains the data. Now, in this toy model of what physical science is like, the theory is going to be a bit string, a finite sequence of zeros and ones, and the experimental data will also be a finite sequence of zeros and ones. In a computer, everything is binary, so it's just bits of information. And we have to explain the experimental data precisely. I'm not interested in prediction, I'm not interested in statistical theories. I want my theory to be a way to calculate exactly what you observed bit by bit. And you see, this is very different from the original formulation by Leibniz and Hermann Weyl. We're not dealing with real numbers. Here, everything is discrete, zeros and ones. And a theory is not an equation. A theory is a computer program. It's an algorithm. It's software. And now, Leibniz's and Weyl's insight, how does it look in this context? Well, it's very simple to formulate. The theory is good if it's much smaller, more concise, fewer bits than the data it explains. What counts is compression. Compression. If it's a good theory, this will be a lot of experimental data, and this will just be a few equations, some simple ideas which enable you to calculate the experimental data. To the extent that this is much smaller than this, you have a good theory. If all the now there's always a theory which is the same size as the data. It basically says, print this or output this from a table. So there's always a theory the same size as the experimental data. What counts is when you can compress. So this corresponds to Hermann Weyl's remark that if you allow arbitrarily complicated theories, there's always a theory and the concept of theory becomes vacuous. Okay? So this is a new kind of way of looking at complexity, and this is a new kind of mathematics involving the notion of a computer, an algorithm, and software, making this play a fundamental role in philosophy of science. So what does this have to do with beauty? Well, I would like to argue that one kind of beauty, you know, there's the old notion of beauty as symmetry that goes back to the ancient Greeks. The circle is beautiful because it's the most symmetrical. This notion of simplicity is sort of related to that kind of beauty. Something simple. So the world is beautiful if it looks very complicated, but it's actually very simple because it follows from very simple laws. That means that the world is a great work of art done by a great artist, God. That's the idea. Or in other words, it's saying that the universe is really comprehensible. It is, there is no ignorabimus, there's no we cannot know. You can't be in a... Leibniz was not an agnostic. He believed that everything could be understood rationally, including God, I think. So this is this idea. And a number of us have worked on this since the 1960s. It's related with a field called algorithmic information theory. It's a different kind of information from Shannon information, from Boltzmann entropy, but it's related. You know, in the history of ideas, these are all first cousins, these ideas. Now, what can you do with this? So I submit that this has something to do with beauty, perhaps. Simplicity. A theory is beautiful if it's very simple. If you have a very simple equation that is explaining a phenomenon that looked very difficult to understand, if the whole world turns out to be explained by a small set of equations, that would mean that the world is actually beautiful. These equations are beautiful because they're simple. I don't know how convincing that is to you, but it's sort of a more sophisticated version of the notion of symmetry. Okay, so this is a kind of beauty, of conceptual beauty. These would be very powerful ideas which generate the entire world. Okay, so that would make them beautiful. I don't know if beauty is a multifaceted concept. There's a subjective element. Beauty in different areas is different, the notion of beauty, I think. But here I'm trying to pin down a kind of beauty that I can define mathematically and work with mathematically. So to do mathematics, you have to restrict the meaning of beauty to something that is sharp enough and simple enough that I can study it mathematically. So I'm definitely not pretending that this is a definition of all kinds of beauty in all areas, but this is perhaps one kind of beauty that I can study mathematically. So what can you do with this kind of beauty? So the idea was then, although Leibniz doesn't talk about beauty, he says it's a most perfect world, that God is most perfect in that the world is very rich and diverse, but follows from very simple principles, a small number of very simple principles. It's sort of a bad maximization problem because you have to simultaneously maximize the diversity of the world and minimize the complexity of the concepts or the laws of physics that give rise to this world. It's sort of ambiguous. It's in this sense that God is most perfect. It's in this sense that it's the best of all possible worlds, not in the sense that Voltaire... the original title of Candide, which supposedly was anonymous, wasn't written by Voltaire, was Voltaire ou l'optimisme. The word optimism was invented by Voltaire to ridicule Leibniz, whom he didn't understand. So this is the idea, best of all possible worlds, this is optimistic. This is the best of all possible worlds, the optimum. So, so what can you do with this idea? Well, I think that a lot of fundamental physics has this kind of beauty. I wouldn't say that nuclear physics has this kind of beauty, or high-energy physics, used to be called particle physics. You know, as Einstein said, it's a zoo, or it's like botany. You know, he said, I'm only interested in one particle. I want to really understand the electron, you know, and now there are hundreds of particles. So that requires a different kind of mind. Einstein wouldn't be good for that. The kind of mind that is good at dealing with a zoo of particles is somebody like Murray Gell-Mann. Now, Murray Gell-Mann is a very different kind of personality than Einstein. He has an amazing memory. He can hold all the facts in his head. And, for different periods, science needs different kinds of thinkers. I personally don't like nuclear physics. I think it's ugly. It also has dangerous applications. But there is still a physics which is very beautiful because it's fundamental physics with very simple equations. So that beauty still exists in physics. It hasn't all disappeared with the zoo of high-energy particles and things like nuclear physics, which is a very phenomenological theory. Nuclei are very complicated beasts, and there are no really... theoretical understanding is difficult for these messy objects called nuclei. Okay, so what about pure math? This is my comments on theoretical physics. What about pure mathematics? Well, in pure mathematics, was it 2 days ago, I was sitting in a beautiful church, and I was amazed to see Kurt Gödel's face there. Let's look at pure mathematics. Is pure math beautiful? Is pure math beautiful? In the sense that I've been talking about. So what would it mean that pure math is beautiful in the same sense that I've just said that I think fundamental physics is beautiful? In a sense that I think Leibniz would understand, because he expressed it very clearly in 1686. Well, pure math, David Hilbert thought that pure math was beautiful. This was about a century ago, in the sense that there would be a single formal axiomatic theory that applying the rules of logic to a finite set of axioms that everyone could agree on would give you all of mathematical truth, every theorem, the entire field of mathematics. So this would show that the Platonic world of mathematics looks very rich and complicated. There are an infinite number of theorems, but in fact it has only finite complexity, because it's very simple. It follows from a small number of axioms and rules of mathematical logic. This was Hilbert's idea. In fact, Hilbert thought this was the case. It turns out it's not. But this still is a very good definition of what it means for pure mathematics to be beautiful in the sense that people hope that fundamental physics is beautiful. It would be if all of mathematics, really the world of Platonic world of ideas of pure math, really followed from a small number of principles using the rules of logic. So it would really have very small complexity, very finite complexity. That's why pure mathematicians like math, because starting with very simple ideas, you can prove things that don't look simple. You see, so actually pure math has this hidden simplicity. Okay? So Hilbert, this is, Hilbert is now saying what it means, what is this faith in pure math that mathematicians have, in the beauty of pure mathematics, in the beauty of pure of mathematical ideas, that they're simple and powerful but enable you to prove very unobvious mathematical assertions. What happened with this idea? Well, I already mentioned Gödel. What happens with this idea actually turns out to be wrong, surprisingly. And there are really three names associated with this. One is Kurt Gödel, one is Alan Turing, and less well known is Emil Post, that I happen to like. This was from the 1930s, basically. And what they showed is usually known as Gödel's incompleteness theorem. Now, I would like to say it using complexity, using this idea of complexity that I've just been telling you about. It turns out this is not the way Gödel or Turing or Post analyzed the incompleteness question. The world of pure, the Platonic world of pure mathematics, of mathematical ideas, has infinite complexity. But any one of our theories, any formal axiomatic theory, only has finite complexity. In fact, if a human being can understand the theory, it has to be rather small complexity. And if a mathematician is going to feel that these axioms are true, it has to be, they have to be fairly simple and intuitive, right? Otherwise, no one will believe in them. So any mathematical theory can actually only encompass an infinitesimal part of mathematical truth. This is a complexity simplicity version of what's normally referred to as Gödel's incompleteness theorem, that there is no one formal axiomatic theory for all of pure math. But I'm giving you a version that is based on the notion of complexity. Now, so this means what? This means that pure mathematicians thought pure mathematics was beautiful, but does it mean it's actually ugly? Well, it's not so simple. The most complicated object in pure mathematics, one of the most complicated in pure objects in pure mathematics, is a number called the halting probability that I believe is referred to in the festival booklet, which is defined, well, there's a mathematical expression, but I'm just going to write it. You don't have to understand it. This is the take a big bag, throw every possible computer program in it, shake the bag, pick out a program at random, and ask, what is the probability that this program halts? This is connected with Turing's famous halting problem. So this is going to be a number between 0 and 1, this probability. You know, it's going to be 1 would mean every program halts, 0 would mean no program halts, and some programs halt and some don't. This number has a simple mathematical definition. I've sort of written it here and explained it to you briefly. But it turns out if you want to write down its numerical value in binary, bit by bit, depends on your choice of programming language, by the way. If you want to do this, it turns out what you have is infinite irreducible complexity. Every bit in the numerical value looks like an independent toss of a fair coin. It's a perfect simulation within the world of pure math where all truths are necessary truths of a contingent truth, of something completely random. This is like concentrated creativity, the bits of this number, concentrated mathematical creativity. It's like a crystal of pure creativity. Every one of these bits, to know whether it's 0 or 1, is giving you one bit of information about the Platonic world of mathematical ideas, and every bit gives you another bit. There's no redundancy. And this is sort of a maximal compression of Turing's halting problem, to be precise. So this is an infinitely complicated object. This is infinite irreducible complexity. Maybe I should write that down. This is infinite irreducible complexity in pure mathematics. So let me show you this in writing. So let's write it in binary. Maybe it's going to be 0.1101, who knows. And this is infinite irreducible complexity in pure math. Irreducible complexity. It has no redundancy. It's a perfect simulation of independent tosses of a fair coin. But in pure math, but this is a single number. You know, these are necessary truths. Infinite irreducible complexity in pure math. So now, let's look at this. Is it ugly? It's not simple. I was saying that simplicity, I thought, had something to do with beauty. However, here we have this object, which is the opposite of simple. Now, there is, however, some beauty to it, a different kind of beauty, perhaps. It does actually have a simple definition, mathematically. But it's not a simple definition that enables you to calculate it. It's a more indirect definition than the theories that I demanded should be software, or the axioms for mathematical theories using logic is really software also. So this is a definition of a number, but it's a non-constructive definition. It doesn't determine the number's numerical value, it just defines it mathematically. But it's very simple. You know, you need a description at another level. It's not computable. So it's, on the one hand, it's very beautiful because it's a very simple definition, very natural. It's it's taking Turing's halting problem, a famous question from 1936, and making it into a real number, by going from the halting problem to the halting probability. But on the other hand, we're getting infinite irreducible complexity. So on the one hand, that means mathematics, let's make it sound good. And people were depressed about Gödel's incompleteness theorem because it meant mathematics wasn't beautiful. Mathematics didn't give absolute truth. We couldn't agree on all the principles. But there's another way of looking at this. The other way of looking at this is that what we have here is concentrated mathematical creativity, all in one number. So this is beautiful in a different kind of way. You have here the essence of creativity, of new mathematics, all in one number that we can imagine, we can talk about, but we can't calculate. So it's a mysterious object that has a very simple mathematical definition, but that escapes us. Now, I think this number actually connects pure mathematics with biology. Because remember that in theoretical physics, the people are still hoping for a simple fundamental theory of everything. It's still the hope. That's part of the reason that fundamental physics is thought to be beautiful. In biology, nobody thinks there's a simple theory. Biology is very complicated. Organisms are... There are no simple laws for a human being, for an elephant, for plants, for bacteria. So biology is very complicated. Well, what this shows is that pure math is actually very complicated too. In fact, it's infinitely complicated. So in a sense, it's even more complicated than biology, which is very complicated but only has finite complexity. Pure math is more biological than biology from this point of view. So now maybe I want to talk about beauty. How am I doing for time? Oh, I'm going too fast, actually. I want to talk about beauty, a little bit about beauty in biology. This is a very different area. You know, I think if you look, for example, at a panther, is that the fastest animal or is it a jaguar? I don't know what it is. But if you look at biological organisms, they're all amazing. You know, every one of them is beautifully adapted to its ecological niche. The creativity of biology is just fabulous. And if when I see a healthy animal in the wild, they're quite amazing, not just the great cats, but all animals, actually. And simplicity doesn't seem to be a relevant concept to describe the beauty of the world of biology. Now, I would like to, nevertheless, as a pure mathematician, I would like to find some hidden simplicity in this richness. I would like to understand biological creativity, and my wife Virginia and I have been working on a field, a very embryonic field, we like to call metabiology. It's not a theoretical biology, it's more abstract. But it has to do with Darwinian evolution. So, how does Virginia put it? It's an attempt to extract fundamental concepts from biology. It's in order to make a mathematical theory, as I said, we have to simplify. We have to So this is like a toy version. Virginia doesn't like it when I say it's a toy version of evolution by natural selection. And I guess the point I'm trying to make is that there is a basic theory in biology which some people think explains biological diversity, which is Darwin's theory of evolution. And as a pure mathematician, I have to say that I'm not convinced. I would be more convinced if there were a mathematical proof that Darwin's theory of evolution is really capable of explaining the diversity of sophisticated life forms that we have on this planet. You know, that the time that evolution has operated on the surface of the planet is sufficient to create all this diversity and creativity, biological creativity. So metabiology is sort of a proposal to try to see if some basic mathematical ideas can be brought to bear on this question, not to settle the question definitively. You know, one doesn't ever settle any important question definitively, but it's an attempt to maybe throw some light on it with new concepts. So anyway, this is a meta-theory of biology. This is not a theory of biology. This is one step further removed. Metabiology takes the idea that DNA is software and studies organisms which are only software, have no bodies. So it's like organisms which are only DNA. But instead of studying the evolution of DNA, which is natural software, metabology studies the evolution of artificial software, which are computer programs. So you have random mutations and you have selection and you try to prove that you get biological creativity in this toy, in this very simple world. And what does this have to do with beauty and biology? Well, I think it has something to do, because if Darwin's theory of evolution is correct and really does explain all the biological creativity, it will mean that this world, with all its great richness of all the amazing life forms that that are in different, populate different ecological niches, really is explained by a very simple theory. It may be very complicated what you get, but there is a theory which is the theory of evolution by natural selection with random mutations. I don't know if it's enough to explain what we have here. But if it were, that would mean that it actually is a hidden simplicity in biology at this meta level, one more remove. It doesn't enable you to calculate how an individual organism is designed or will evolve, but it does give you a sort of a general model of the evolutionary process. And if you can show that it sort of is reasonable to expect that a process like this can be creative enough, that would find a hidden simplicity, mathematical simplicity, in an area where it looks like pure mathematics really doesn't apply. It doesn't. Biology, you see, in fundamental physics, pure mathematics really is useful, right? Pure theoretical physics, fundamental physics, is very mathematical, right? But there is no theoretical biology in the same sense that there's a theoretical physics. So this metabiology is not going to be, even if it gets fully developed, it's not going to be a theoretical biology that is like theoretical physics. It is a meta-theory. It is one step removed from real biology. It's looking, I'm saying, forget about evolution of DNA subject to random mutations. Look at organisms instead at the evolution of computer programs subject to random mutations and natural selection. And maybe this will give an area which is simple enough that you can apply mathematical methods. So there are a few initial steps that it's possible to take along these lines. And my wife, Virginia, and I, plus one student, I had one PhD student who already completed his PhD in Rio de Janeiro, we've been the people taking a look at this idea. Virginia is a philosopher. She's been looking at it from the point of view of interdisciplinary epistemology, concept migration, how ideas go from math, from biology to math, move around from field to field. So I was afraid I was going to run over, but it seems like I'm too fast. I've only been speaking for 3/4 of an hour. I've been going too fast. I hope that the simultaneous translation could keep up with me. Is it okay, gentlemen? Did anybody understand what I was saying? Okay. Maybe what we should do, since I think these are the basic idea that I wanted to submit to you. So my field is not really the field of beauty. I don't know what beauty is. I'm enthusiastic about it. That's why I do mathematics. But I don't know what it is. But I think maybe it has something to do, at least in some cases, with something that I do know something about, which is simplicity and complexity. So I've talked about simplicity and complexity, which may have something to do with beauty, in theoretical physics, in pure math, and in biology. So in theoretical physics, it's the fact that there are simple laws. This goes back to Leibniz and to Hermann Weyl. There are simple laws that explain a very rich world, the one we're in. Now, in pure math, it was thought that there was a simple set of axioms, rules of logic, that would give you all of mathematics. That was part of the beauty of mathematics, supposedly. That was the reason that people want to be pure mathematicians. That's part of the reason it gives absolute certainty that mathematical truth is black or white. Unfortunately, this is not the case. Gödel, Turing, my own work. However, pure math turns out to have a different kind of beauty, maybe more closely related to the beauty in biology, of being an area where there's an infinite amount of creativity that is possible. You see, the omega number is like a concentrated essence of creativity. And creativity, I think, my wife and I feel, is a very important word in biology, which, however, has sort of been forgotten. Biological creativity is not something that is talked about a great deal in population genetics, for example. Population genetics looks at how the frequencies of different genes varies in a population in response to selective pressure. But it doesn't talk about where new genes come from, and that's the creative part. So this metabiology, what we have is a very simple-minded theory that biologists don't, you know, can't take very seriously in general. They think it's ridiculously primitive. But it is a field in which we can talk about creativity, you see, which is not possible in population genetics or in the normal mathematical formulations of evolution. So I think that the I think that beauty is a very important term. I don't see why it's worth it to live if we don't have beauty, if we don't have something that transcends the human, that raises us from the mud, that gives the epiphany of seeing something very beautiful for the first time, or understanding something, a beautiful theory, for the first time. I think that's what makes life worthwhile. But another word which I think is very important is creativity. That's why it's fun to do mathematics. As Post put it, Gödel's theorem is not bad, it's good. It means that mathematics has infinite scope for creativity. It's not a dead subject. It's not a cemetery. It's alive. It will evolve. It has infinite scope for creativity. Future generations have a lot to do. It's not a finished subject. You know, a formal axiomatic theory is like a cemetery for a subject. It gives absolute certainty, but it's the certainty of death, in a way. So I think that the question of creativity in biology is connected with the question of creativity in pure mathematics. Maybe I'm wrong. I think that what Gödel's incompleteness theorem really is, it's opening a door from pure math into theoretical biology. You see, so this is my attempt to view the work I've spent my life on, which is Gödel's incompleteness theorem and versions of limitation results in pure math, to look at them in a positive light rather than a negative light. And I should say on this topic, I don't know if I explained any of this at all well, but I want to say another reason that I'm delighted to be here is because we have here my friend Karol Jalochowski, is it? Jalochowski, I'm sorry, Polish is beyond my ability to pronounce. And he made a very nice documentary. He's made a series of documentaries of crazy scientists or crazy thinkers, pioneers. And one of them is about Julian Barber. It was shown earlier this week, and Julian spoke yesterday. On Friday at 10 p.m. Here in Krakow, you're going to be able to see in the Kino Micro the documentary that Karol did about Virginia and me. He visited our home on the island of Pakatá, a tropical island, and He talked to us, asked us what we were doing on metabology, and we tried to explain. It was rather confused what we said, but Carol, amazingly enough, seemed to extract a pretty coherent message, which you can see in his documentary. In addition, you can see what a tropical island in Brazil is like and what its inhabitants are like. So if even if I didn't explain anything at all well, perhaps if you're interested, you can come on Friday at 10 p.m. and see this film. I think it's a marvelous film done by Carol. Thank you very much.
Thank you, for Professor, for the nice lecture. And ladies and gentlemen, that's the right time to questions.
Should I be listening here to the question in English?
I have one question and one request. You mentioned a person who has a different mind than Einstein, and I didn't catch his name. Can you write it down? He's able to remember all the details, all the facts, in contrast to Einstein, who only can... You mentioned a name.
I mentioned Hermann Weyl.
No, it was later.
Who?
Gell-Mann?
Goldbach? No, I didn't mention Goldbach. Murray Gell-Mann. Let me write his name
down. Please.
I don't like him, though. I mean, I don't like his... the kind of science he does. It's not a personal matter. Let me write his name now. This is a different kind. This is the sort of the other extreme, Murray Gell-Mann.
Murray Gell-Mann.
This is high energy physics.
Yeah, he got the Nobel Prize. Yes,
right.
But my question is about the part of your talk about physics.
Are you a physicist?
Yes.
But I hope I didn't offend you too much, sir.
You were talking about beauty in physics, and you said that nuclear physics is ugly.
Are you a nuclear physicist?
I work in Institute of Nuclear Physics, okay. But my question is, you said that the fundamental physics is beautiful. Can you be more specific? What do you mean by fundamental physics? Because I understand that the fundamental physics will be beautiful if the theory of everything will be developed. But right now, I don't see any difference between nuclear physics and other part of physics. They are very similar. I don't see any difference.
Well, perhaps the theory of everything is more a religion than... There is no theory of everything yet.
Yes.
I think that's an accurate statement. But if you look, say, at the Schrodinger equation, Maxwell's equations, Einstein's field equations, Newtonian physics, of course. Those are beautiful chapters in fundamental physics, right? Let's start with Newton's laws, then Maxwell's equations for the electromagnetic field, then Einstein's field equations for in general relativity, and finally curved space-time, and finally the Schrodinger equation. I agree that this isn't a theory of everything, but these are really beautiful chapters in theoretical physics with very simple laws. You know, nuclear physics, in a way, is like biology. You're dealing with very complicated entities. Big nuclei are complicated systems. And I understand that the physics of it is rather phenomenological. You know, you don't have a simple equation. Is that a reasonable... Yeah. Now, there's a kind of beauty. I mean, all of us, if you're doing nuclear physics, I'm sure you find it beautiful. You know, so I'm not claiming to capture all kinds of beauties. As someone said yesterday, beauty is in the eye of the beholder, right? Otherwise, we would all want to marry the same woman and it would be a disaster, right? But I'm trying to capture a particular kind of beauty that I can study mathematically, which is a notion of simplicity that I can define rigorously via algorithmic information theory, okay? But I agree, this point of view is a sort of a toy view of what physics is about. It doesn't allow statistical theories. The theory has to give an exact explanation of the data. You know, this is the problem I have as a pure mathematician, that I need to work with toy models, otherwise I can't prove anything. Okay, so this is intended, how do you say, modestly. The one case here of a model which was taken very seriously by people is the model of Hilbert's proposal that all of mathematics should follow mechanically applying the rules of logic to a finite set of axioms. This is still a sort of religion in the world of pure mathematics, in spite of Gödel in 1931 and Turing and later developments. And that is also a caricature of what how pure mathematics is actually done. But it's a caricature that it's fashionable to claim captures the essence of pure mathematics. Now, I certainly don't claim that metabiology captures the essence of biology. I haven't talked about it too much. And I did talk about this toy model of a physical theory, which goes back through Hermann Weyl to Leibniz, and that is certainly a caricature of what theoretical physics is like. But it's something that I can make mathematical statements about. So that's the advantage of this viewpoint, which I agree has severe limitations. Now, we probably should have a biologist here criticizing this next, or maybe a mathematician, I don't know.
Okay, the next.
Now, for me, population genetics is probably the most mathematically oriented part of biology. And I think its foundations are fairly simple.
What field? I'm sorry, I didn't understand.
The population genetics, I mean, which you sort of...
Dismissed.
Well, yes. Which I think it's an attempt to investigate the fate of genetic variants in the populations under a wide variety of conditions.
I agree.
So that's one thing.
It's a beautiful theory, and it was part of the reason that Darwinian evolution was taken seriously. What was it called? The modern synthesis was based on genetics, population...
Yeah.
Population... what do you call it? What is that field called again? Population genetics? No, I don't know. What is it called? That you're talking about. Genetics, no. Well, anyway.
So I think paleontology, I mean, would be the third component of the Darwinian, modern synthesis.
Right.
I mean, and it's doing very well because it's predictive, can be applied to the DNA data, which we collect in vast numbers. And it's also predictive in a way that is discovering new world. I mean, so all the kinds of microbes or the microworld, I mean, has a genetic identity, right? And yes, we use that to see the complexity which we haven't seen before. So I think it's...
No, population genetics doesn't talk about complexity. Pardon? I beg to differ.
No, not the population genetics. Right. In a sense, it does not. But, yes and not, because what can be done, one, what he explains origin of genes, right? And origins of certain traits. Mm-hmm. So it explains how families of genes arise.
No.
Yeah, it does.
No, you postulate all the genes to start with. What you vary are the frequencies.
No, you look at a very simplistic way on it. This can be applied in such a way that, for instance, genes are duplicated and they can be then occur in more variants, not just variants of one particular entity, but the different entities which act together.
You seem
so
very
I mean,
well
the very point. Simple one, the Fisherian one, right? Yes. The Fisherian one. It's 1930s. But it was developed when people really didn't know what genes were about.
Yeah, I can't hear a thing in this hall, the echo. But is this your field, sir?
Partly, yes.
Mm. It's a beautiful field, and a lot of good work has been done. However, I feel that this approach, which is not as useful as population genetics, which you work in, I agree this is much more theoretical and abstract.
Well, it is. You see, and then... Yeah,
but I think that here you are talking... Here I'm able to talk about something. This notion that DNA is like software is taken as the basis of this theory.
Oh,
and
right.
I can see that you couldn't care less. Okay, well, you know, it's wonderful that there are
different fields.
Everyone can work on the field they like. I don't want people to take away funding from your research on population genetics. I think it's a splendid field. But I'm proposing a viewpoint which is different, not to replace the work that you people have done, because it can't, obviously, but to give maybe a little insight, maybe, maybe not. This is an embryonic field that has just begun, and I feel that perhaps there's a little promise in looking at this. But, you know, this whole set of ideas is very theoretical. It's very philosophical. I'm basically dealing here at the level of metaphysics, epistemology, philosophy of science. This isn't science. This is some kind of meta-theory, analysis of biology, mathematics. I call it metabiology, meta-mathematics, and metaphysics. These areas, I don't call it. Two of them already have had names. So this is intended as a game, as a proposal, a philosophical proposal dealing, saying that the basic emphasis, the basic idea here is that maybe the idea of software or algorithm, okay, let me put it this way. I think the computer is more revolutionary as a philosophical idea than as a new technology. So this is an attempt to take epistemology, philosophy of science, and put the idea of algorithm at the foundation. And it's not a new idea, because it can be traced through Hermann Weyl back to Leibniz. And Leibniz worked on computers, right? Leibniz is a remarkable mind. Now, this is all very philosophical, very theoretical, but it has one thing, which is that it marries fundamental ideas in epistemology, in the philosophy of science, with the notion of the computer. So the computer isn't left out as just a technology. Maybe it becomes a crucial philosophical concept. That's what I'm proposing here. But this is not a practical proposal that how we should do work in biology, right? So this is the idea is the notion of complexity or information here is sort of connected with epistemology. Another way to put it would be epistemology as information theory. And there are three chapters, one on metaphysics, one on metamathematics, and one on metabiology. So this is just a modest proposal. And I certainly think that beautiful work has been done, and I assume continues to be done, in your area, and by all means, you should continue. Here, the problem is, in fact, that this is a very embryonic proposal, and in fact, there are only three of us who have worked on it. So I don't know if it has a future. The most success it's had so far has been that Carol came from Warsaw to Brazil and made a very nice film where we talk about this. But I don't know if these ideas have a future or not, to be brutally honest. You know, this is a proposal for a different viewpoint, and one of the reasons I'm happy to be here to present it is because of the very high intellectual level here in Krakow, and at this festival in particular, where everyone has a philosophical background. And there are many places where I go and philosophy is like a dirty word. You know, it's like something obscene to mention philosophy. And I think all of us agree that that is not at all the case, you know. So this is intended as a suggestion perhaps for a different apersu, a different view in the philosophy of science, perhaps. Using the idea of complexity, simplicity, information, or algorithm or computer is another way to put it. And I don't know, so far the only person who seems to have liked these ideas was a very talented filmmaker from Warsaw called Karol Jalokowski. Yeah. Okay,
we have the next question.
Let's not fight, since we all are believers in philosophy and in good science, right? And that's not always the case. There are places where science is done just for money, you know, for practical applications. And I won't mention any names, the misguided parts of the world where this is the way people think about science. But that's not the case here, I believe. That's why it's a pleasure for me to be here in Poland talking with you.
Thank you.